Good evening, everybody. I'm James Steward, and I'm director of the Princeton University Art Museum, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to this evening's program. This is offered on the occasion of World AIDS Day and Day Without Art, a day on which we commemorate the loss of so many creative talents to AIDS, and on which we draw attention to the continuing struggle experienced by so many facing AIDS around the world. The ways in which our museum has marked this occasion have varied significantly over the years, and this year we are honored to welcome two extraordinary guests who have each given voice to the AIDS crisis and led the fight against it, while also being exceptional creative talents. The first of these is our own Edmund White, who is not least professor of creative writing here at Princeton, as well as being the author of some 20 books. I discovered Edmund White in his earliest novels, including Forgetting Elena, published in 1973, and Nocturnes for the King of Naples, published in 1978, novels whose lush and distinctive prose made a profound impact on me. He's perhaps best known for his trilogy of autobiographical novels, A Boy's Own Story, The Beautiful Room is Empty, and The Farewell Symphony, which together chronicle the life of a gay man from boyhood to middle age. But he's equally renowned as a biographer, in particular as the author of A Life of the French Writer Jean Genet, for which he won the National Books Critics Circle Award, as well as for biographies of Marcel Proust and Arthur Rimbaud. Ed's most recent books are Inside a Pearl, My Life in Paris, and a new novel, Our Young Man, published earlier this year. In the same year that he published A Boy's Own Story, Ed helped found the gay men's health crisis during the very earliest years of the AIDS epidemic. He went on to do something very similar in Paris when he lived there during much of the 1980s. When Ed graciously accepted my invitation to speak today, he asked if I would mind if Larry Kramer joined him. I try not to be so stupid as to have to ask twice. And so we were truly delighted when Larry accepted. Larry Kramer is an American playwright, author, public health advocate, and activist. He began his career rewriting scripts for Columbia Pictures, which led him to London, where he wrote the screenplay for the 1969 film Women in Love, for which he earned an Academy Award nomination. Larry's 1978 novel, Faggots, introduced a controversial and confrontational style and immediately situated him as an early and important writer on matters of modern identity. It was also sufficiently controversial within the gay community that it got him banned from the grocery store near his home on Fire Island. Larry acted as one of the most important voices in the AIDS crisis, first in co-founding Gay Men's Health Crisis, which grew out of an initial meeting that he convened in his New York apartment, and has grown to become the world's largest private organization assisting people living with AIDS. Larry's play, The Normal Heart, first produced at the Public Theater in New York City in 1985, gave voice to his frustration at both bureaucratic paralysis and public indifference in the face of AIDS. The play is considered a literary landmark and was named one of the 100 best plays of the 20th century by the Royal National Theatre in Britain. Larry's political activism continued with the founding of the AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power, better known as ACT UP, in 1987, an influential direct action organization that is widely credited with changing public health policy and the perception of people living with AIDS. Larry Kramer has been a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize for his 1992 play, The Destiny of Me, for which he also won two Obie Awards. We are honored to have two such extraordinary talents with us tonight. After offering their own remarks and reading from their work, Ed and Larry will take questions from the room, after which I invite all of you to join us and chat with our speakers at a reception in the museum galleries. And I should note, the reception is in the galleries, not in the lobby of the art museum where someone else is having a reception tonight. So if their food looks better, keep walking. On your way to the reception, I'd like to draw your attention to two things. The first is the opportunity to buy copies of Ed's book, Our Young Man, and of Larry's The American People, Volume 1, both in the museum store. Ed and Larry have kindly agreed to sign books at the reception, so that will also happen in our galleries. The second is that we've installed a selection of photographs from our collection that speak to the crisis years, including work by a few artists who themselves were lost to AIDS. So without further ado, these two extraordinary gentlemen, I am profoundly moved that you're with us tonight. So welcome, Ed and Larry.
It's good to see you here. I notice that most of you are not students, and that's sort of sad that so few students are here, because we still have a plague on, and it's going to be more theirs than ours for many years to come. In any event, this is a is from my book, The American People, which is the first volume of my history of America. It's a novel. I'm working on volume two now. Let me know if you can't hear me. You can hear me? Okay. The lighting is really hard to read by. Is it possible to get more light?
It's maxed out. Yeah. It's maxed out at that. There is a light at the podium, if you'd rather.
There's a light at the podium, but you
okay, can you hear me now? The American Revolution is the first successful colonial war of independence. This unprecedented success is achieved against one of the most powerful nations extant, a country that is the greatest naval and financial power of the world. It is important to know, as the most stringently vital of all lessons about the early history of the American people, that the American Revolution is not what it's cracked up to be. John Adams said that a third of the people didn't even want independence, a third didn't care one way or another, and the rest were probably faithful to the crown, some 50,000 fighting on the British side. And one out of every five traces roots to Africa. So this 20% of the American people don't fight at all. Rich people stay at home and poor people can't afford to leave it. Between 10 and 20% of the inhabitants of Boston, New York, and Philadelphia are genuinely poor. And the soldiers of the American people run away with regularity. While George Washington and his staff are at their parties, those who remain of his forces are half starved, half frozen, and entirely unhappy. It's a wonder we had any army at all, certainly not one we can congratulate ourselves for so many centuries. Some of us fight, of course. We even have rebels, mobs, they're called, a radical fringe. It's not a concept that many have given much thought to yet. Prime are the Minutemen of Massachusetts, so-called because they're pledged to arrive in a minute, the joke soon arising whether their name describes their readiness or their ejaculations, so close a bunch in affection are they. Plenty of British are against the war, too. Their biggest argument, don't bite the hand that feeds you. America is a good customer. They try every which way they can to tax us. The Molasses Act, the Currency Act, the Stamp Act, the Quartering Act, the Sex Act, the Coercive Act, the Intolerable Act, the Manchester Act, the Townsend Act, the Foreigners Act, the Hemp Act, the Barrel Tax, the Second Molasses Act, the Third Currency Act, the Fourth Stamp Act, the Fifth Quartering Act, the Greenville Program, the Fifth Coercive Act, the Intolerance Act, even something called the Bedding Act. Finally, the Brits squeeze us too much. There is also a Sodomy Act that allows Britain to export to the colonies all those so inclined or caught in the inclination. How many are actually sent here? No one is counting, but sent here many were. Statistics are still scarce for this war. Dead Americans, 4,435 out of 290,000 soldiers. Dead Brits, 10,000 out of a much larger fighting force. But these statistics do not tell the real story, that roughly 9 American soldiers succumbed to disease for everyone killed by the British. Smallpox killed more than 100,000. Measles, influenza, mumps, typhus, cholera, plague, malaria, yellow fever, scarlet fever, whooping cough, diphtheria caused their own revolutionary devastations. Syphilis is rampant among George's troops. Who else is there to fuck, for goodness sake? So yes, the revolution is a big win on paper for our side, but noble is not the word to use. The American people do need their glorious history. It's like an addict who needs a fix. When you haven't got much decent history to begin with, noble it up. How did we win? In a nutshell, the enemy was lazier than we were. The most undocumented fact about our revolution is that it was the first time American men held each other in their arms as they were struck down and died. The first time they cried over another man's body and kissed so many comrades goodbye. Men had not seen men behave like this. Men had not known they could feel and act like this. And these feelings and these acts burrowed their way into their hearts, their bones, their minds and souls, and remained there, searching in vain for safe ways to get out. Yes, America, the United States of America, is born out of this. Since the first moment he saw him, George Washington wanted to take Alexander Hamilton into his arms and make love to him. Turbulent experiences of intricate male intimacies are not unknown to either of them. Alex, born illegitimately by a Jewish mother, had his cock sucked by one of her, quote, husbands, end quote, when he was very young. He was raised and exceedingly well educated by 2 other men who were lovers. George, throughout his earliest years, had his cock sucked and fondled by his old queen of a neighbor, Lord Thomas Fairfax, who couldn't keep his hands off him. Neither boy had a father he could love. George hated his, and Alex was never sure whose his was. Alex learned quickly that he was handsome enough to cause men to want him physically. George learned that his pockmarked face required powder in public, as did his peculiarly reddish, unflattering hair, and that his sagging body required increasingly elaborate corsets and tailored adornments of disguise. Did Alex know that his life would be tragic? Did George? No one has ever considered George tragic, much less sad. These are muddy tributaries that biographers of the truly great men don't want to navigate, lest their men appear less manly. How could anyone as poor as both Alex and George have been, the one in background and birth, the other in self-knowledge and regard, not have felt some great indefinable hunger along their journeys, George from his primeval wilderness and Alex from his impoverished tropical islands, both to the very sleeping quarters of the first president of the United States. Is this the stuff of tragedy? It is when it informs such harsh inequities of the heart that disallow the man to be the man he wants to be. It is doubtful that George Washington ever experienced a fully happy day in his life. And the two great loves of Alex's life will be taken from him. These are never detailed or even mentioned. By the many historians who worship George, who do not tell us that, of course, he was homosexual and much in love with Alex, the most handsome man he'd ever seen, and that Alex was in love with him. Alex will also love and fuck his beloved fellow officer, Jack Lawrence. He will fuck men and women throughout his short life. He will have a scandal or two along the way, usually because of a woman. Scandals with men are never reported, of course. Sometimes, as with George, he will manipulate a beloved to guarantee his own desires, his own devices. Alex's vision of America is not everyone's, and it is his that will prevail, in the process winning him the enmity of Thomas Jefferson, who wants the states to run the country instead of letting the country run itself, and who is a complicated and most expert and manipulative politician himself, claiming to be Hamilton's friend when in fact he is his enemy. It is Alexander Hamilton's America that we live in today, much more than Washington's or Jefferson's or any Adams or Madison's or even the great Lincoln's. Alex gave us banks and money and international trade, commerce, and solid national credit. He talked his George into everything he wanted, Alex did. What wonders what George or America would have done without him. George Washington is aware that dozens of men are hanged for sodomy, which is already against the law. But he has worked out for himself the notion that loving the boys could be perfectly acceptable as long as it remained within certain boundaries. He thus established America's first version of a future president's 20th century ignominy, don't ask, don't tell. Yes, the general is no fool when it comes to understanding how bodily needs, one way or another, can take a mighty hold. If he did not have his hand-picked group of officers to touch and invite to sleep by him and with him throughout these years, throughout these battles, he would go crazy. It is painful for him in their group garrick to watch Alex and Jack make love, just as watching Alex sodomize Jack mightily pains him. George has no intention of hanging either one of them. Alex dares to broach the matter with the general, sir. There is in all this something greatly askew. Washington will not discuss it. Hamilton is accustomed to this silence. He boldly takes his George's hand. He holds it without letting go. George does not remove it, but he will not look into Alex's eyes. The mighty general is mightily moved. Would he not cry if he knew how to? Once there, one so instructed by life, what is there to do with a love like this? Jack Lawrence is murdered during a useless skirmish with the British in August of 1782, and thus not allowed to receive the latest of many love letters that Alex, now married, had sent to him. Jack is the greatest love of Hamilton's life. Alex's passion for him exceeds by far what passion he feels for his good wife Eliza, who bears him 7 children, all of whom he rarely sees. His own voluminous papers, which are often starkly honest, reveal numerous dalliances through the years. Many of these are with young men. Alexander Hamilton commits suicide on July 11th, 1804. He is either 49 or 51 years old. His papers reveal that he knew he would not fire at Aaron Burr, and that Burr, an expert marksman, would fire at him with great accuracy. His George by now was dead some few years, and Alex has become increasingly depressed. God forbid he should wind up like George himself, there on that hill with only a Martha to talk to. He is mourning not only George and Jack, but also his lack of interest to anyone and anything else. That he even bothers to annoy Burr so much, and the argument on both sides is about petty things, that Burr feels he has no option but to call for this duel, is an indication of just how depressed Alex is, and what an opportunist Burr is. Alex just does not care. Now there is no George to indicate a job well done. Yes, he misses George mightily. He created for his George his strong central government, an effective tax and tariff system, a national bank. Because of him, for the first time, America can actually pay its bills. The U.S. Mint, the Bank of New York. He's written with Madison the Federalist Papers, which molded the Constitution itself. He battled hard for every single one of these against major opposition, all for his George, who was smart enough to listen. Several days before his death, he comes across his correspondence with Jack and his files on Maria Reynolds, the hooker who years ago had obsessed him to such a degree that the public exposure of their pair put paid to any notion he could ever run for president, even should he be able to manipulate the Constitution to make that possible. He did not want to be president anyway. George wanted him to. George had been his goad and goal throughout his adult life, the father he never had. Their love for each other was mutual. Jack had been his other greatest love. "Mind you do justice to the length of my nose," he wrote to Jack, nose being code for cock. He also wrote him, "I wish that it might have been in my power by action rather than words to convince you that I love you. They joked about marrying each other somewhere on some distant island. He sent his last love letters to Jack before he knew that Jack had already been shot dead. They were returned to him unopened. He never forgot his receipt of the news that Jack was dead. It was said that he howled so in pain and anguish, it was as if the winds would carry the echo of his helpless cries throughout the world. He must have thought about all of this before he faced Burr in that duel and aimed his pistol at the trees. No, the American Revolution's not what it's cracked up to be. Thank you.
Maybe we should have some discussion and before I read, or otherwise, too much reading. Later.
One question I have listening to that, and in a way it's really for both of you, obstructed in a way a thread between some of your writing is certainly the kind of idea of writing back into history and visibility things that have been omitted. Could you maybe talk about that in your respective writing, about kind of correcting the record?
Correcting the record. Correcting the record.
Oh my, this is my version of correcting history, is that what it's
yeah.
Yes, it is. Gay history is simply not taught in America. Gender studies are, queer studies are, gay history isn't. We don't have programs here, as I understand, which I find kind of teachers are and who are willing to investigate these kinds of things. Everything in my book through the centuries who I believe were gay. Of what my research has built certainly has to be scholarship, much as we were finally able to do with Walt Whitman. Which is more or less proceeding with Lincoln. I think it is just so important for gay people to know who we were in history.
Let's try two.
You didn't hear any of that? Anyway, that's my my current passion is trying to get us to know who among us was gay, knowing that Abraham Lincoln, the greatest president the country ever had, was gay, that Alex and George were gay, going to make it a lot easier to be a homosexual today, I think.
I don't agree at all with Larry, but because I don't think that what we call homosexual was what they would have, I mean, they wouldn't have even recognized the reality of it. because everything changes so much. I mean, the forms of love change so much. And I'm not saying that there wasn't same-sex love, but the way people conceived of it was so different in every culture and every period. Yeah, so we don't agree.
We've been here since the beginning of time. We've been here since the beginning of history. We've been.
There we go. That's it.
There may not have been a name for us, but men knew when they felt that they wanted another man. That's a.
I mean, if you, I completely disagree because, like, if you look at Greek homosexuality, it was only permitted between adult men and teenage boys. If the boys got an erection, they were considered sluts. The only way that they could have sex was intercrural, which means between their thighs. And it was with the parents' permission, and it was a form of education. I mean, that's not our idea of homosexuality. And the Renaissance is entirely different. In Louis XIV's court, his brother was homosexual and had a whole shadow court. But the men had to pledge that they would never go backwards and become heterosexual again. I mean, because in other words, the thing about being gay was so precarious and so unnatural to people that only the king's brother could oblige them to be that way. Anyway, you can just go on and on and on with different theories about this, but in like the romantic friendships of the early 19th century are now construed as being gay. But I had a friend who wrote a very interesting biography called The Sexual Labyrinth of Nikolai Gogol. And in that he showed that Gogol probably was gay, but his very good friend Pushkin, who wrote him very loving letters, probably wasn't. I mean, and he had a very good ear for hearing the difference between the early 19th century romantic friendship and real homosexuality, which was something other. But anyway, we'll never agree.
Yes.
Well, you know, Alan Berube wrote a book about World War II, and he dates modern homosexuality to World War II, saying that because of the war, they had all the necessary conditions for coming out. That is, they were far from home, they had a little bit of money, they thought they would die tomorrow, and they were separated from the opposite sex. And so And a lot of those people who actually were gay, not just faute de mieux, but were actually gay, settled on the West Coast in these beach towns like Santa Monica. I mean, in a way, Isherwood represents that kind of homosexuality that came out of World War II. Anyway, that's Alan Berube's argument, which I think he supports very well. The question was, do we think that she agrees with you that soldiers dying in each other's arms in the Civil War were really expressing a kind of tenderness? And do we think that war helps people to come out?
Yeah. Well,
certainly
did in World War
I. Well, when you look at the history of disease, of syphilis, through the centuries. How high the numbers were at time of war. And you realize that these were men making love with other men.
But why not with prostitutes? Hmm? Why not with prostitutes in the local?
Because if you're in the middle of nowhere and there are no women, there's...
There are always some women.
No. It's very interesting. A lot of new stuff is coming out about the history of HIV, and that in fact it has existed for hundreds of thousands of years. Prior to we knowing about it, and starting in 1981, it was indeed rampant in parts of Africa, among both men, soldiers, and prostitutes. So I don't think one is going to rule out either of us.
Yeah.
It's really interesting. We had been told. I have now come to that part of era in my life where I truly believe that AIDS has intentionally been allowed to happen. Going into too much detail. The Trump can take over a world. Ronald Reagan did the same sort of thing when he came into office. These cases in Africa that started in 60 through the 1970, were known about it. We didn't know about it, but somebody here knew about it. There were American doctors there. Why weren't we told about that? And then one day we wake up and the New York Times says, rare cancer found in 41 homosexuals. And from that moment on, AIDS has been lumbered as a gay disease. When in fact, women already had it, not only in Africa, but in America. So, it's a lot of food for thought. When we first got involved with HIV at Gay Men's Health Crisis, you know, there were a handful of cases. No one would pay any attention to them because they thought they were only gay. So today you have a worldwide plague of hundreds of millions.
That many? Aren't there only 40 million? I thought there were 40 million. 100 million.
But all over the world.
All over the world, there are 40 million, I think. All over the world, there's supposed to be 40 million people with AIDS.
Whatever. it will be many, many. It'll be... Gallup predicted 100 million. We're not there yet. Most of the world, that's a huge proportion of the world that is infected, doesn't know it or doesn't have access to anything to do about it, including in America. And here we got another health president who's going to appoint a health commissioner who's going to see that that medical care is going to be more curtailed. you're living through very strange, perilous times.
The vice president, and he, I guess most people know that, but the vice president elect in Indiana wanted to take all the funds for AIDS and assign it to
conversion therapy.
Pence wanted to use the money for curing AIDS to cure homosexuality.
Yeah. Yes, many fights ahead. Many fights ahead.
Yeah.
So you talked about that New York Times article is starting to distort what AIDS was as making it a gay disease. And I wonder if our soul a gay disease when it clearly wasn't. But I wonder if nowadays, given like the integral role that it's played in fostering modern gay life as we know it, if there's something positive in claiming it as a specifically gay disease.
Since AIDS played such an important role in creating modern gay society, maybe there's something positive about calling AIDS a gay disease.
Positive? Make that rich.
Well,
I think what gays have been able to achieve via mostly through ACT UP and activism has been extraordinary. Every single medicine that's out there for HIV is out there because of ACT UP. Major protest, major activism by hundreds of terrified young men who were finally angry enough to finally confront the system in a coordinated way. I don't need anything to make me positive about being gay. I love being gay. I do.
But do you think do you think AIDS energized the modern gay movement?
Well, I got to tell you, I don't know what the modern gay movement is. Everyone keeps referring to the gay movement. The movement is something that moves and has a lot of people out there, and not enough of us are out there fighting. Compared to how many people there are at the height of the really bad AIDS days in the mid-1990s, in the various ACT UP chapters across the country, say we had 10,000 people doing various kinds of demonstrations. But if there were, 20 million or however many there's supposed to be of gay people, that so few people were out there fighting for their own lives is sad. Just like I'm sad that there are not more gay people here today.
Ed, I think you also prepared a reading for us tonight. Would you like to offer something, and then maybe we can just take questions on any subject?
Oh, he wants me to read. He wants me to read. This is an excerpt from my book, The Married Man, and the main characters are Austin, who's an American, and his lover, who's dying of AIDS, Julien. A furniture dealer in Paris had told Austin to be sure to see the Berber Palace that was just off the road between Tarodont and Ouarzazate, before the turnoff up through the mountains back to Marrakesh. "It's completely out of the way," the dealer had said, "and very beautiful. We ate lunch there." Julien and Austin drove there with a guide. The guide had another Koran to show them, badly battered, perfectly square, slipped inside a leather satchel that folded shut like an envelope and could be worn on a chain around the neck. "You put a chain through this hoop," the guide said. Then he laughed, showing his stained teeth. "Not you, of course, but one." His laugh turned into a cough. Julien shifted away from him, afraid of being exposed to tuberculosis. Austin was certain that that fear was going through Julien's mind. Despite his fears, Julien bought the Koran and was never seen without it afterwards. He fell asleep with it on his lap, usually still in its scuffed and water-stained leather case with the coarse stitching. Sometimes, when he was drowsy from morphine, he'd thumb through the pages with their long, cursive comet tails and their bug-track vowel signs, which looked like those radiating dots in comic strips that indicate delighted surprise or sudden enlightenment. It was the perfect book for a weary, dying man, pious, incomprehensible pages to strum, an ink cloud of unknowing. Julien was wearing a cotton kaftan with tan and white vertical stripes over a t-shirt, under a gauzy white kaftan and a white wool sweater he draped over his shoulders. He kept the sweater close by in case he began to shiver. He'd abandoned his jeans, since the seams cut into his fleshless hips and legs. Only in these robes did he feel comfortable. His black hair was thin and oily, pressed into a cap on his head. Many white hairs were scattered through the black. Seen from behind, his ears looked immense, especially if the sunlight was shining through them, perhaps because his neck had become so scrawny. His eyebrows had grown shaggy, and his nose looked much bigger, as if old, he's only 34, as if old age, frustrated by his quick decline, had decided to rush ahead and hit him now. Although he walked very slowly, he was still game. He wanted to go places and see things. If he sat tranquilly in one place, the morphine would make him fall asleep. He smiled sweetly wherever he went, though he spoke so softly people couldn't hear him, and Austin would have to repeat what he'd said. When he smiled, his face broke into hundreds of lines that hadn't been there 6 months earlier. The guide, who knew not to wear them out with his talk, kept silent in the back seat and spoke only to indicate the way to the Berber Palace. Austin appreciated his discretion. He obviously sensed that they were living through a difficult moment, but he didn't ask questions or let his curiosity show through. The day was hot except when a breeze blew. Then they were reminded that winter had just ended and that the mountain peaks on the horizon were still deep in snow. They slowed down as they rolled into a village of low houses and teeming streets. The pedestrians' dull-witted stares were the look of grouchy nicotine withdrawal. It's during Ramadan. They took the road to the right. A little farther on, the macadam gave out to be replaced by gravel. Soon they came to the massive structure of the Berber Palace, with its alternating square and rounded arches, its tile roof, and its pale blank walls. Sometimes a small window, barred, was pierced into a wall, always at an improbable place, as if the rooms inside were of madly varying heights. As soon as they'd gone down two steps and along a walkway redolent of thyme, they were in an immense garden planted with palms, crowding up from geometric plots of clipped bushes. The walkways were lined with white and faded blue tiles. A few tiles were missing. The inner courtyard was still large enough to seat a symphony orchestra. No one was around. Caged birds hanging in doorways were singing and flickering in the shadows, twitching shuttles of gold through the gloom. A small fountain drooled into a clear basin. Through the water, green moss could be seen, waving from black boulders like hair on drowned heads. The throne-opened doors here and there were carved and painted wood, decorated with abstract sunbursts. Like a bored shopper at the bazaar, the sun itself was feebly fingering the dusty lusters of a chandelier far inside a room, with no intent to buy. They went in one door and could smell stale smoke from last night's banquet. An empty plastic water bottle had been thrown on the carpet. A tiled dado lined the walls all the way around at shoulder height. Their guide, Ahmed, clapped loudly and called out something in Arabic. At last, a white man in his 50s could be seen crossing the courtyard. He was wearing sunglasses and had a full head of graying hair, cut short and spiky, that grew low on his forehead. He had a goatee that emphasized the squareness of his jaw. His loose orange sweater was decorated with wide black bands on the sleeves, like an exaggerated sign of mourning. He seemed self-conscious walking toward them in sunlight as they watched from the shadows. At least his stride looked unnatural, and he hung his head until he'd come within calling distance. He tried to speak French, but with a German accent. Within a moment, they'd all found their way into English. He explained that he was German and a friend of the owner, who was Muslim and sleeping through the difficult Ramadan day. "Do you think we can eat something?" Austin asked. "An omelet. I'm sure they could make you a cheese omelet and a green salad. Would you like to eat outside in the sun?" Austin turned to Julien. "Would he be too cold?" The German suddenly shrugged and said, "I don't work here. I'm a guest." He smiled. "I don't know why I'm interfering." He looked at Julien. "You won't be cold. It's protected from the wind." Julien asked where the toilet was and shuffled off toward it with Ahmed. The German said in a low voice, "I can see how ill your friend is. Is he your son?" "No, my friend." The German, who said he was called Hermann, touched Austin's arm. They were seated at a rusting white metal table on the pale blue and white tile floor. Unseen birds were chirping from within the stand of trees toward the entrance to the grounds. "What is that delicious smell?" "Orange blossom," the German said, and then added confidingly, "I know what he has. My friend just died of it. Your friend is not long for this world." "Oh?" Austin asked nervously. He felt a flutter of panic play like fire over his solar plexus. The early spring was so calm, with all the daytime torpor of a small Moroccan village, and even though it was noon, the sun seemed veiled and remote. Was Julien about to die? "He's come so close to dying before, but he always survives. He has miraculous powers of recuperation." "No," the man said, shaking his head. "He's dying." "Oh, this is German coarseness," Austin said to himself, quick to label the offending stubbornness, although he knew few Germans and usually detested the almost inevitable generalizations everyone made about national character. Hermann added, "I'm a doctor. I watched my friend." He interrupted himself and touched Austin's sleeve again. "It's all right. We needn't say the name of the disease, but I know what he..." "Do you say what he suffers of?" "From, you say from," Austin put on a bright social smile. "And what brings you to Morocco?" "I will tell you all," the man said solemn. "I am bisexual. I have a good wife I live with since 30 years. But my real love is my friend. I am a doctor, a narcozert, Anesthesiologist? Yes, but a doctor of that. But my friend was a famous surgeon. You see, he pointed to a neat scar, 15 centimeters long, buried in his clipped hair. I had a brain tumor, most unusual. That's why I have trouble speaking. I know English very good before, but now I forget, and only slowly, slowly the words come. For a moment, Austin was confused. He thought the friend, the surgeon, had been a brain surgeon and had removed the tumor. But a moment later, Austin had reshuffled the kaleidoscope and saw the same elements in a new configuration. He smiled and said, "Your English is perfect, don't worry. Did you know your friend for many years?" "Yes, yes, all my life. He was 20 years older than me, but age meant nothing to the soul's kindred spirits." "Yes, that. And did your wife know him?" "Oh, yes, we were all very close. You know, in Europe, we do not go into details." "No, but she knew." "Ah, here comes your friend." Julien was slowly coming down the long alley of trees and boxwood hedges. He stopped to gather a mass of orange blossoms in his arms and to breathe in the fragrance. He was smiling as he walked with tiny, stiff steps toward them, accompanied by the deferential guide, who was frowning. Julien's outer robe was faintly damascened, which made it shine when it caught the light. Over lunch, Hermann talked on and on. It seemed that his older lover, the friend, had fallen for a Berber from this very village. "My friend bought this palace and installed Ali in it. His plan was to turn it into a hotel that Ali could run. But Ali, who is 30 now, ah, how time like a bird," he mimed flapping wings, "flies. Yes, how time flies. He said that Ali had never learned how to run a hotel. He'd become obsessed with sports car racing and had never concentrated on ordering food, supervising the staff, holding down expenses. When my friend was dying, he asked me to look after Ali. Now I'm here, although I have had much mental loss with the tumor. Ali's family is challenging his inheritance of this palace, as is the commune, as are the Pasha's original descendants." This man with the unsmiling mouth, the big, unironic eyes, and the look of confusion traceable to his scarred skull seemed disturbingly intimate and real. For so long now, Austin and Julia had been rocked in the comforting arms of French gaiety and discretion, the illusions made possible by silence or elision. Now here was a flat-footed German with a metal plate in his head and a verbal problem in several languages, who was, with all the misguided kindliness in the world, making them look at the inevitable from which they'd so long averted their eyes. "It's strange for me," Herman said. "I'm here to recuperate, but all I can do is worry and worry about Ali." With a familiar Teutonic gesture, he performed an immense shrug of his shoulders and let his lifted hands collapse rhetorically onto the slats of the chair he was sitting on. With the same gesture, he propelled himself into a standing position and said much more loudly, "Gut, we go?" "Go?" Julien asked, blinking. He'd been smiling into the garden and looking at his uneaten omelet as though he were a mild-mannered child to whom the gruff natives had offered an inscrutable toy. "Where are we going?" The German said, "I don't have a car, but you do. I thought we could all take the dirt road up into the mountains to Ali's village. They'll make us mint tea, which for them is a great luxury. And you can meet Ali, who you'll see has lost his looks and become fat as a eunuch." Oh, Austin thought, a eunuch. What a tempting idea. They drove a few miles out of town into the foothills where the gravel road gave out and they were there were just two continuing ruts in the mud. After another mile, Austin decided they couldn't continue because the bottom of the car was scraping against the turf. Julien said, go on, I want to see the village. No, we can't, Austin said. We're scraping the bottom of the car. We'll destroy the motor. We'll be stuck here. Our insurance won't cover the repairs. It will so clearly have been our fault. Julien, who was sitting beside him, said, "Oh, I'm so disappointed. You have no sense of adventure. I wanted to go there." Something about the way he said it made Austin think he was referring to the foothills of death. No, that was a fancy way of putting a simpler intuition, that Julien was expecting something to happen to him up there that now would never happen. Julien left them and went walking across the valley. Somewhere out of sight, over the next hill possibly, several men were hammering something and all talking at once. What are they doing? Austin asked. Building a house, the guide said, though how he knew exactly, Austin wondered. The sound was peculiarly close and present, irregular but frequent blows of hammers on something hollow sounding, perhaps stakes being driven into the earth, after all. A soft breeze was blowing and tossing and gathering the folds of Julien's white robes as he walked. The ground up here was stony and barren, the color of sand, though the pebbles and rocks would need another 10,000 years to be ground down to grains that fine. Green trees, wind-trained and full as giant bushes, were dotting the tan hills all the way down to the distant verdant valley. There were no clouds in the sky, except along the horizon. At first, Austin wondered if they might be snow-covered mountains, but then they drifted slightly. The guide stood apart, as if afraid of disturbing them with proximity. He suddenly hunkered down in a crouch, with his back to them, and looked off to the valley. Hermann stood near Austin, kicking a pebble with his right foot. Austin looked at Julien, whose white caftan was glowing with the suffused daylight and was floating in the shifting but constantly flowing breeze. Austin took three pictures as Julien walked back toward them. Austin thought, oh, Julien, such a romantic boy. He's probably communing with nature in preparation for his death. And then he thought, that's exactly what he's doing. It's not a pose, it's a reality. He's communing with nature in preparation for his death.
So are there questions that anyone from in the room would like to pose before we think of adjourning to the art museum? Perhaps in response to this reading, Ed, anything? You looked like you had a thought. No.
Okay. No thoughts.
Yes.
Thanks for being here. My uncle died of AIDS 21 years ago, December 1995. If he were alive today, he had AIDS, he probably wouldn't have a death sentence. He worked on Wall Street. He was a relatively well-off white man. I noticed in the room there are not a lot of people of color, but the HIV prevalence rate in the United States for among Black Americans is 8 times the rate for white Americans, and among Hispanics is 3 times the rate of white Americans. So I'm wondering what are the possibilities for more coalition formation between gay rights activists and activists for racial justice and equality?
Could I actually just throw one other statistic at you, because I just happened to read it today, that apparently transgender women are 45 times more likely to contract AIDS, which goes maybe right to the same question.
I can't hear you. Why don't you come and sit here?
Her question was about whether there are ideas for coalition building around issues of AIDS and social justice, particularly around issues of race and...
I'm sure there are attempts to do all this. It's never been possible to get these things going, that's all. Activism requires everyday attention, and most people are not willing to make that contribution. AIDS is terrible, in many populations in this country, as well as around the world. Yes, there are organizations trying to deal with other organizations, but the organizations are small and powerless. We have a government that, we have always had a government that has really allowed all of this to happen in terms of HIV. The research on a cure is light years away from what it should be, or should have been, and would have been if this were thought to be just a white man's disease. It's very dispiriting. It's dispiriting, too, that activism per se for almost all major issues is not as active as it should be. Interesting to watch now what's happening in response to the protests against Trump, if they'll be able to achieve anything.
Well, I think that Trump, and especially the threat to First Amendment rights, will make people a lot more outspoken. I think writers also will be more important, actually, in our culture. I mean, that's wishful thinking, but I do think that that all of us who want to speak out will play a bigger role and be more conspicuous, I hope.
You know, I will just observe, when I was thinking about introducing you today, I was thinking about the power of ACT UP in the late 80s and wondering whether it didn't afford some inspiration or even ideas of a model for some of what may be needed in the years to come. In terms of thinking about effective direct action.
No big mystery about activism. What makes you angry? How do you rectify it? What are your goals? We knew we wanted medicine, cure, whatever. So we were able to zero in on what we wanted. And the people who were responsible for not giving it to us. Other two major activist movements of the last few years, the Black Lives Matter. Yes, and the Wall Street one were all very touching, but they didn't have goals. They just paraded. They marched around Washington Square and sat in Washington Square. You know, they didn't go chain themselves to anybody's desk or go down and invade Wall Street and all the things you have to do. Really have to be very imaginative and very confrontational. And it helps to be angry and it helps to be afraid. Those are both great motivators for action. I mean, the models for successful grassroots organizations are plentiful.
I'm reminded that I wrote a biography of Jean Genet, the French writer, and he, in 1968, when there were the student rebellions in France, he went to a big meeting they had in a theater. And all the leaders of the student movement were sitting on the stage, and all the followers were in the audience. And he said, as long as you have this model, you're just going to repeat things over and over again. I mean, there's no way to break through. If you just replicate the forms of domination and submission that are in the culture in general. And he was very aware, being a man of the theater, he was very aware of that kind of thing. For instance, he was interviewed by the BBC, and he said, I don't have anything more important to say than any technician here who's filming me. In fact, I'm going to turn the camera around and interview them. And he had a problem with English, so he couldn't do it very well. But he had a very good idea that, you know, that everybody is as important as everybody else, and you need to break down the forms of hierarchy that govern our society.
Any other questions from the room?
Got all their tongues.
Well, Ed, I appreciated your endorsement or your optimism about the idea that perhaps writers will become yet more important to us. I hope the same is true of artists. I've seen an interesting trajectory just in the last few weeks from the moments after the election where a number of artists I know were questioning whether they could continue to make art, sort of saying, you know, this has challenged my fundamental belief in the validity of my art making if despite our collective best efforts to date, this kind of event is happening. I'm wondering, you know, what you're observing beyond your comment that you hope that the role of the writer becomes ever more important.
Well, I mean, that argument that art is useless was advanced after the Holocaust. You know, that Adorno said after the Holocaust it was pointless to make art at all. But fortunately, that didn't turn out to be the case. And I think art oftentimes has been one of the most powerful ways of dealing with the horrors of the Holocaust, for example. I think I think a lot of writers, because they're dealing with words and with messages, are worried about the First Amendment rights and about the Trump administration actually censoring things. And I think that will make people more outspoken and more defiant, I hope.
Me too. Activism in America, activism is sort of for creative, in the creative world of literary writers, activism is something they don't seem to partake in. When you think of many great writers in South America, and for instance, or Spain, or
Eastern Europe too.
Yeah, who are also very powerful activists. And their literary reputations not in any way been sullied because they are also activism. And compare it to America, when most of the great writers are not out there. I'm amazed at how many famous writers who never have said boo about AIDS helped us in our fight, Nobel Prize winners included.
I think that, I mean, I teach creative writing here at Princeton, and one of the things that I have to overcome with my own students is that they feel there's something kind of corny or tacky about having a message.
Yes, I mean, I know that.
You know, like you have to say, well, wait a minute, you could actually, I mean, I try to get them to read Tolstoy because he had a few messages.
I know that my reputation as a literary writer has suffered because I am such a loudmouth activist. And I'm reviewed not as a good writer, but as a loudmouth activist, which is sort of annoying.
Anyone? Hmm? I'm just seeing if there are any more questions in the room. Well, yes, one more.
I'd just like to thank you very much for everything that you have done for the AIDS movement and for so many lives. Thank you.
Well, Larry is the one we should thank.
Well, we're not through yet. Thank you.
Well, I feel inclined to say to the room that inspired by these two gentlemen and their lives of conviction and contribution, that maybe we should all go forth, whatever our politics, and be angry and stay angry about whatever the issues are that are closest to our own hearts and minds. I am a museum director that has a conviction that an art museum is a place that should be about helping people become better citizens on a variety of levels. And so maybe with that thought in mind, I hope we'll all walk across and join us in the museum galleries for a little bit. Thank you all.
Thank you.